So there are school students as well as college students working on earthworms. So they'll be talking about how do they culture the earthworms and what work some college students who are collaborating with them, they are doing some studies on the earthworms. So studies like regeneration studies. So they'll be talking about it. So I'll just Abhijit, yeah.
Abhijit.
Or you can Abhijit and your group, na? Yeah.
Myself Vedant. I am studying in 7th standard. I am from Adarsh Vidyalay.
My name is Mithali. I am studying in standard 7th. I am from Adarsh Vidyalay.
My name is Mithali Kamre. I am studying in 8th standard. My school name is Adarsh Vidyalay.
My name is Atharva. I am from Adarsh Vidyalay school. I am studying in 7th standard.
Myself Harshal Kedare. I am studying in standard 8 and my school name is Adarsh Vidyalay.
My name is Mitesh Kamle. I am studying in 8th standard and I am from Adarsh Vidyalay school.
We are from Adarsh Vidyalay. We are working on Earthworm project. What is an earthworm? Okay. Earthworm is an organism which we can found under the big stones, in the soil, or in mostly we can found in rainy season. Immediate term objective is how. Our immediate term objective is to catch earthworm by soap water method. Our short term objective is to culture earthworm in different mediums like tissue paper, filter paper, magazine paper, and newspaper. Our long term objective is to find which culture they live more efficiently.
How to catch earthworms? First, we have to take liquid soap solution. Then we have to pour the liquid soap solution on the surface of the ground. After that, we have to wait for 15 minutes. Then the earthworm will come up off the surface. We have to catch the earthworm with the help of the paintbrush. We have to wash the Then we have to keep the earthworm in a tray and wash them as much time as possible, because we have to remove the liquid soap from the body of earthworm, because they can harm the earthworms. Now, how to make a soap solution? First, we have to take 1 liter of tap water. Then we have to add 10 ml of dishwashing liquid in it. Then we have to mix them in a conical flask. Then we have to pour it on the ground. After that, earthworm will come up on the surface. We have to catch the earthworm with the help of the paintbrush. Then we have to wash them. Thanks.
How to make cup culture? First, to make cup culture, first we take two plastic cup, then make hole into a bottom of the plastic cup. After then, put some wet tissue paper. Then make the earthworm and put them inside the cup culture. Then next, put 15 layer of filter paper on the surface of the tray. Make it wet by some water. Then cover it with muslin coat. Cotton. Your cup culture is ready.
Observation. Our observation for the objective were the earthworm which in the tissue paper were alive in excellent condition, and the earthworm which in the filter paper they are alive but one of them are dead. Died. The earthworm in the magazine paper they all are died because of the less weightness of the magazine paper. This is our result for the earthworm observation. Conclusion. From this we see that the earthworm alive in the tissue paper they are in excellent condition. Future plan.
Our future plan is that it is to see the earthworm how they are regenerating.
If you all have any question, please ask. Thank you.
जय जय किधर सेव किया है सब पीपीटी कौन सा तुम्हारा कौन सा देख ये फाइनल ये 2 MB श्योर Where is the PPT again?
Hello. Okay, yesterday we had a visitor in the lab. Her name was Vidyut. So she mentioned that it is not necessary to pour soap water in the soil to collect the earthworm. So she suggested some alternative methods. So she's been quite a geek. And though she didn't actually go to any college and study biology, she knows a lot of things. And possibly she's the only person in entire Mumbai who grows insectivorous plants in her kitchen garden. And so very soon we're going to have insectivorous plants in cube as well. So because she's going to help us, she's going to mentor us how to do it. So she told us, when we told about this method of earthworm collection, she said that what you just have to do is go to the garden and put some carton that you get this packing material, such thick paper kind of thing, just put it on the water and just leave it damp at the end. Just leave it for 2-3 days. After that, when you lift the paper, most of the earthworms are already just laying just below the cotton sheet, which is also already being eaten and decaying and things like that. So you will see the earthworm already coming there. And so I want you to test this. Okay, so design an experiment, okay, and try to check. You know, it could be, let's for example, just some newspaper or cotton or whatever it is. Okay, so just keep it on a wet, damp soil, leave it like that for a few days, and then disturb it only after 2 days. But otherwise, you know, you can keep checking what happens under the thing. So if this method is actually successful or not. Okay, so I'm not saying that soap water is not the method, because that is also widely discussed all over. But suppose if something like this is done, that means we don't have to spoil the soil with soap. Okay, it's much more organic and sustainable method of doing things. So let us see whether that will. So that can be, can you make that as another objective of your experiment next time? Okay, thanks.
Good afternoon.
No, no, you don't have to do that. We people who shop around in your vicinity will give you those packings. Otherwise, you know, they are thrown away anyway in the dumping ground. So you don't hesitate. Wear some gloves and pick up that waste paper and then put it on the soil and use it. Reuse. You don't have to do any online shopping for that.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm from Elphiston College. Myself, Manasvi Dekate, and my colleague is Rushikesh. So we are going to present here is developing E. fetida, earthworm, as a model organism for cancer biology. So what is our abstract? So how are we going to plan our model our experiment to make it cancer biology model? So everyone knows that earthworm usually regenerates, or everybody knows that earthworm regenerates. So the basic thing is, if we amputate an earthworm, what happens first is there's a bleeding. So basically, to stop that bleeding, first thing happens is the clotting of blood. Later, a group of cells come together and goes for dedifferentiation. Now, what do dedifferentiation mean? Dedifferentiation is a group of cell goes into its initial position, or initial cell which do not know its own function. It's basically they don't know any function, but they are just going and dividing. So it's dedifferentiation and have a growth in a very controlled manner. So basically, when we amputated our earthworm, they restored their lost segments and in a very controlled manner. Whereas in cancer, what happens is the cells goes into dedifferentiation, but they don't have any control on their cell division. So what our objective is that if we can understand a molecule which is responsible for having a growth in a controlled manner, and that molecule, if we induce it in a human cell as a cancer therapy, then it will be a very effective therapy or a treatment for human. This is our long-term objective. So our immediate objective is to basically maintain a cup cultures of an earthworm. Now the short-term objective. So our short-term objective is to understand how the regeneration takes place. It's like if we consider an earthworm, and first earthworm if I'm amputating at 24th segment, and the second earthworm if I'm amputating at 34th segment. So basically 24th one is also going to regenerate, whereas the 34th one is also going to regenerate. But the rate of restoring that segment will be different. So to understand that, at what rate it's restoring, or how much time it requires to restore that segments, so that we can understand that, okay, on 24th, if it's restoring faster than 34, so, and basically taking a time, also considering a time. So we'll understand that, okay, the molecule or the factors which are having a huge effect for regeneration are present on this segment and not on this segment. Okay, there will be presence of molecule, but not at that level, whereas it will be present on 24th, if suppose, like if it's restoring very fast. So this is a short-term objective to understand how the regeneration is taking part in an earthworm, and the long-term objective, developing an earthworm as a model organism for cancer biology.
So basically I'm gonna explain you the experiment, what we did for the this experiment. So we took three sets of earthworm, and first set was for the head amputation, second was for the tail amputation, and the third was for the middle amputation. What we did in head amputation, we know that the earthworm has two sides, that is anterior, which is head part, and the posterior part, that is tail part. So in head amputation, we designed like a project. In head amputation, we amputated the earthworm from the anterior part, like head part, at the 8th segment, and we gave the name, like you can see here, we gave the name for the head amputation, so HA1, HA2, HA3. What's HA stand for? The initial, like a head amputation. A stand for the anterior part, which is small part. This small part which we amputated, and 1, 2, 3 are the in one head amputation we took 3 earthworm. So we took 3 earthworm for one set, and so on for the tail amputation and middle amputation. Similarly, we amputated for the tail amputation. We amputated from the tail side, 8th segment. Tail side from the 8th segment. That is the smaller part, and this is the bigger part. And we name that set. We name that set as a TA1. T stands for the tail amputation. A stands for the anterior part, like a TP1, like a T for tail amputation, P for the posterior part, and 1 for the experiment number of the earthworm. Okay, and for the middle amputation, we didn't measure the exact number of segment which is present on the earthworm. So we approximately took 108 segments that we actually counted under the microscope, dissecting microscope. And for middle amputation, we did actually half of the full segments, like 108, then it become 54 segment. So we cut at the 54 segment here, like 53 and 52. That's our three sets, okay? The 54 segment. And we named that parts as a, here you can see, stands for the middle amputation, and A stand for the anterior and posterior parts. Like we can see, this is the anterior part which have clitellum and the head, and the posterior part which have the anal pore. Okay, so what was our hypothesis? First we have the very foolish hypothesis, like all amputated part regenerate. And all the amputated part restore all the segments. Like here you can see that this small earthworm can, according to our hypothesis, that this small part can regenerate fully segment, like clitellum plus anal pore, like this. And for the middle amputation, what we did, if we cut at the middle segment, there will be a 2 earthworm from 1 earthworm. Like here you can see this part, like MA, like we can see that MA1, this earthworm will regenerate all the anal segments and also gut area, and this posterior part also regenerate clitellum plus head. Okay. The protocol for amputation, what we take that we take a petri plate. Here you can see that we petri plate, and we place ice between two petri plates. Okay. We place earthworm on the petri plates. We put it into the under the dissecting microscope. And then you have to magnify that we can see that easily. And here is the one precaution what we made is that for amputation we took a blade which is swapped with the ethanol. So there can be we are going to cut earthworm like we are cutting the wire. So if we that would be gently, not like a wire. And if ethanol swab blade will be good for the there will be no bacteria for on the blade, and that can infect the earthworm. Okay, the protocol for observation, you can see that's me. Yeah. Okay. Protocol for observation, take a petri plate. It's similar like a it's half similar like a protocol for amputation, but take a battery plate, take a ice in between the battery plate, and here we added one option. We add a tissue paper on a battery plate. Here you can see that, and with the help of paint brush, that is smooth. You have to use smooth paint brush. Okay, so smooth with the help of smooth paint brush, we remove the earthworm from the cup cultures and place it on a tissue paper. And here you have to make a measure that you keep sure the earthworm skin is wet because they respire through the skin. And then observe it under the dissecting microscope. So here, Manasvi can explain the report.
So we actually took a report for 94 days after the day post amputation. So this is our first report where we find out something interesting is the smaller part which we showed, the first image, HA2, HA3, TP2 and TP3 died after 5 days, and some smaller parts were still alive after the 5 days. So basically, we don't exactly know the reason why they died, why they didn't restore these segments, because they have the property for regeneration, what we thought, but they didn't restore. And the remaining part, we can say that the smaller part died, and the larger part which were present, the larger part, or the larger segments, were alive and started regenerating, as we showed. You can see the small mark, how they started regenerating. After post amputation. Okay. 5 day post amputation. Then on 30/10/2017, that is 38 day post amputation, what we observed is the tail part, the tail anterior part, restored 25 segments instead of 8 segments, with forming first anal pore, and then the segments started regenerating. So first they formed first anal pore. And also in the HP2, that is head amputated part, they restored first mouth. And something interesting was they restored 6 segments instead of 8 segments. And the third part, which is the middle posterior part, was alive but didn't show any regeneration. And also there was no presence of mouth, which was really very interesting because they didn't have a mouth for feeding. Still they were alive after 38 day post amputation. Then we have 94th day post amputation, that is 24/12/2017. What we observed is as I said, the middle part which didn't had mouth nor he has started regeneration were still alive. And also to make sure that are they feeding, so we make sure that is there any fecus on our cup cultures. So there was no presence of fecus. So basically, we don't know how are they still alive without mouth, how are they taking energy, or how are they feeding, and they are still alive. And you can also observe that the health of this and the health of this part is same. So basically they are feeding on something. They are not in any drought condition, but we don't know how. So these are the interesting questions after our one set of experiment. The first is, what is responsible for alive middle posterior part after 94th post amputation without mouth? Second question is, what is responsible for the growth more than 8 segments in the tail amputation earthworm, that is 25 segments. They restored 25 segments instead of 8 segments. So what is responsible? And third question, what we arised is clitellum responsible for regeneration? Now we have shown the diagram. First, you can observe that the shorter part died, which didn't have any clitellum, but the posterior part was alive, which had a clitellum. Again, in the second part, tail part, we observed that the posterior part, which didn't have a clitellum, was died, but this part had a clitellum and it was alive, and it started regenerating. And in the middle part, we observed that this part started regenerating, which has clitellum, but this part didn't have any regeneration and it was alive till 94th day. So our goof ups.
So here we come with the goof ups. First, we didn't maintain our cup cultures properly. Like we didn't water the tray daily or the interval of 3 to 2 days. And second was we didn't took observation at the specific days. Like you have to be standardized for the observation. Like we took observation randomly when we got a time and all holidays and all. So, third way, we didn't took any exact photos or videos for the how we did amputation. Okay. So, and fourth, we didn't measure exactly that what I told earlier, exact number of segment and what is a approximate number of segment. Fifth is we didn't measure, that was a major goof up, what I think. We didn't measure exactly on which segment is clitellum is present for the test and the control part. Okay. That can be served as a marker for like a measuring other segment from the clitellum. And six was after 38 day post amputation, we observed directly on the 94th amputation. So 68 day amputation. So we unable to find out the regenerated segment. Between this interval, the coloration and the pigments and all, the same, that what regenerated and that what that were prior present, they are like same color. So we want some help here for the future plans. What how can we identify the regenerative part after so long time? So it looks like the same. Okay, so here are the further plans.
So what we thought a major question is clitellum responsible for regeneration? So what we are thinking or what we are standardizing our experiment is, we'll take one earthworm which will be amputated at 24th segment. Generally clitellum starts at 25 or 26 segments and ends at 33 or 32 segment. This is our own observation. So we'll first amputate 24th segment and we'll see, we'll keep it into our respected cup cultures, different. Then again we'll take another earthworm which will be amputated at 34th segment. So now this is the type, anterior as well as the posterior. We'll be having two controls for each type of amputation and experiment will be carried out with the three earthworms. So this is our future plan. So our hypothesis is, the posterior part of the anterior amputation should regenerate, and the anterior part of the posterior amputation should regenerate. This is our hypothesis for the further plans. And this is our reference.
We will stall your questions for now. We will take Simran and Arjun's presentation on earthworm itself, a different approach towards it. Okay, so we'll listen to them and then we can have a combined discussion on this group and Simran and Arjun's group. Okay.
A very good afternoon to all. Our topic over here is earthworm as a model organism for the spinal cord injuries in humans. So, as we know, a spinal cord in humans is a very important organ for its for the vital movement and movement of the body. So, similarly, in earthworms, we see there's a presence of ventral nerve cord in the earthworm, which is equally functional as in humans. So the function of the spinal cord remains the same. There, if there's any injury, that may lead to paralysis. As we know, in humans as well, any injury to the spinal cord may cause complete paralysis of the body. So as we can see, injury to the spinal cord of the earthworm as well, which is the ventral nerve cord, may cause complete paralysis of the earthworm. There's no coordinated movement between the segments of the earthworm, so that leads to the complete paralysis of the earthworm, and the earthworm cannot move. So we've seen that the regeneration of this ventral nerve cord can actually lead to the restoration of the function and can cause movement of the earthworm again. So basically, our immediate objective would be to standardize the process of RER, which is rapid escape response, so that we can conclude a proper conclusion to our experiment. Our short-term objective would be to determine the role of wind signaling pathway, which is a pathway responsible for regeneration of the ventral nerve cord. And our long-term objective would be to develop earthworm as a model system for injuries in spinal cord in earthworms, as and then further take it to humans.
So I'll be explaining what is rapid escape response. That is our experiment. So first I'll tell you, we take a distilled water, which is our control, and then we take the NaCl solution. I guess some mistake is there, so it's not able to see. So first I'll talk about the control. What we do. Due to some technical reasons, the videos are not able to play. So this is the control. What we do, can you see here a test tube? In a test tube, there is 3 ml of distilled water. And then in that distilled water, we introduce our earthworm. Okay, so we remove the earthworm from the cup culture. We wash it thoroughly so as to remove the dirt and the feces and all that thing. We wash it, and then we wash it with distilled water specifically. Then we tap it on a folded tissue paper so that the excess water should drain out and our volume of the test tube won't change. Okay, so after doing that, we introduce the earthworm and with the soft tissue paper, obviously. Observe it for 2 minutes. Now here, the distilled water is not harming the earthworm as such. So the earthworm will be like, okay, the environment is cool, I'm staying here, I'm relaxing here. Okay, so we observe it for 2 minutes, and the earthworm is not escaping from that solution, from that test tube. Okay, so this is for the control. Now we go for the test. That is what we do. We take NaCl solution, salt solution, with the concentration of 200 millimolars. Okay, so what we do, we take the same earthworm and we introduce that earthworm in the NaCl solution, like seen here. Okay, this is for the NaCl solution. We introduce it in the test tube and we dip it completely in that test tubes. Okay, and after that, now here the NaCl solution is creating a problem for earthworm, like it's giving irritation for the earthworm. So the earthworm will obviously try to escape from that test tube, from that solution, so as to, you know, not get irritated or something like that. So we do this experiment. This experiment is RER assay, rapid escape response assay. So this first two diagrams, you can see the videos are not there. So this was done before lesion. Now before lesion is we give lesion to the ventral side so as to cut the ventral nerve cord of the earthworm. And this assay was done before that to see, okay, to specially choose those earthworms which are fit, which are not fit, and we can further use for our experiments. So after done with this, we do it for like 5 times. We repeat this experiment 5 times with the same earthworm. Later on, we give a lesion as Manasui and group had done the amputation. In the same manner, we give the lesion. We give lesion in the central of the earthworm. Like, we don't exactly count to the segments, but we approximately give a lesion at the center. And here, while giving lesion, we have two controls with us. One is when the earthworm which is not lesioned, like no harm done to him, is perfectly fit. The another one is the dorsal side lesioned, which is again our control. Now the dorsal side, because there is no ventral nerve cord as the name suggests. So at the dorsal side, there is no nerve cord. Sorry. And the third one is the test, which is a ventral nerve cord lesion. Okay, so we give a lesion, and then again after 1 hour we do the same experiment with the same earthworm. Okay, and we have been observed that in distilled water it's again not harming, not doing anything. So the earthworm is like relaxing over there. After 2 minutes we take it off, we drain the excess water, and then introduce the same earthworm in NaCl solution. Now what happens here, as in earlier, before lesion, the earthworm was escaping. But here, the earthworm was not able to escape. Why? Now, the question was like, if I'm giving a cut to the ventral side, and the nerve cord is very close to its skin. So the nerve cord is also getting cut, due to which there is no coordination in between all of his segments. The starting segments are telling ki piche wale ko chal aage jaane ka hai, but piche wala sunne ko ready hi nahi hai, usko apni marzi karna hai. So this is the way they are not able to coordinate, the segments are not able to coordinate, and hence the earthworm is not able to move out. He is trying to move, but he is not coming completely out from the solution. Okay, so this is what we have done. This is the experimental design. Further goes to experimental sets. Like we have done we have done this experiment 4 times with different earthworms. Now in the last experiment we have done with very less goof ups, as I think so. So the total earthworms we took was 16. Out of which 10, like the size was 10 to 12 centimeter. The species was Ephitida, those were Clytella earthworms. And now for ventral lesion test, we used E1V, that is earthworm number one, ventral. So as to, no, don't get confused, we should. Then for dorsal lesion, E1D, D for dorsal, and unlesioned is UN. That's again our control. So the results, I have not mentioned it properly because our results were like gadbad. So the most of the earthworms took between 1.30 seconds to 2 minutes to escape from that solution, from NaCl solution specifically. And the earthworms which took more than 2 minutes, as I mentioned, we used to consider them unfit, like they were not used further for our experiments. Now the restoration of the functions after the VNC lesion. This experiment was performed 4 times till now. Every time we used different earthworms. Now the first time when we did experiments, we are not like too much aware, so just kar liya tha. Then we saw the restoration within 2 days. Like after lesion, we did it. After 1 hour we did the same assay, and the next day we did it again, and then we saw that okay, the earthworm was escaping from the NaCl solution. So this was done in May. Then we moved to a second time. That is the second time when we did this experiment. We saw it in 10 days. Like, we were like, first it was 2 days and now it is taking 10 days. So again, there were some goof ups, which we realized. Third time again, it took 12 days, which was done in November. And the fourth time was done in October this year. So, not October, I guess. October. So again, it took 2 days. So we are like quite confused. Where are we going wrong? We are doing many problems. Sometimes we also blame the animals, due to which Arunal sir yelled at us. So right now our future perspective is to determine the role of wind signaling pathway in VNC regeneration by exposing vagara vagara vagara. So Manasvi has told you about the differentiated and the non-differentiated cells. So basically there are some cells, suppose if I amputate the earthworm, there are some cells. So that cells might have been also like exposed out. So they release some chemical, XYZ chemical, and the other cells which are in a proper way, which are given their proper function, those have some XYZ receptors. This chemical gets attached to that receptors and some signaling is done. So basically that signaling which tells you to regenerate, so that is called as a wind signaling pathway. We learned it in our third year now. So we need to first know more about this wind signaling pathway, and then we are going to use LiCl, lithium chloride, which is an inhibitor for the wind signaling pathway. So if there is a role of wind signaling pathway, we could, like, by using LiCl, if it's inhibiting, so we could say that okay, wind signaling pathway is taking place. So acknowledgement will be to Yusuf Mehrali Center, as they has been providing us with the earthworms, and yeah, Cube Lab as well. So here I'm done. So any questions?
So the session is open for questions for this, for their presentation. It's okay, don't look. He's just adjusting, yeah.
Earthworm being a very interesting model system to study a lot of things. We ourselves started with earthworm in our first year as a part of Cube. So first thing I would like to ask you, like, when you do the lesions, so you make sure that the two segments are not apart, like, right? They should be together, but still it's lesioned.
Yeah.
So how you make sure that whatever amount of like lesion you are putting, it's just distorting the nerve cord, but not like...
Basically, we are not able to like know how deep the cut is, but we are making sure like the nerve cord should only cut, and even though the rest of the body is cutting, I don't think so that it should
where be. Where exactly are you cutting it from the dorsal side or the ventral side?
Basically on the ventral side also we give a cut, and on the dorsal side also we give a cut, as it's our control, and the ventral is our the test. So we are basically on giving a lesion, we are like keeping on a dissecting microscope and niche petri plate and eyes, palat dete usko, and observing in the microscope, we give a lesion directly.
One thing I wanted to like bring to your attention is, like, from there they can tell when you cut first anterior 8 segments or posterior 8 segments, and when they are like totally apart from the animal. Have you seen those small segments, anterior or posterior, they actually move on the petri plate?
Yeah.
They try to wriggle, they try to crawl, they try to move, right? But
we
in case of... Yeah, and also I would like to suggest that whenever you guys do something on earthworm, Drosophila, C. elegans or any model organisms, try to find, like, ANDC has put a very good study on earthworms, and anterior posterior segments.
So in fact, they have done the identification thing and the regeneration also they have done. Like,
so if you see the photos and the videos, it's on Meta Studio also.
Yeah.
So my question is, in case of humans, like he was saying, if there's a spinal cord injury, so we get paralysis.
Hmm.
So in paralysis, it's not like we are not able to move that organ or the limb totally. It's not like we can just move, but we cannot walk. But in case of earthworm, if we ampute it totally apart from the organism, that segment still wriggles. Actually, it is walking. So there's no concept of paralysis in earthworm, right?
Basically, in each segment, there is a set of ganglions. Like, okay. So there might be some signal. Suppose the last segment is there and the first or the third segment is there. Okay, so now this person has to move up from the test tube, from the solution. So obviously I have to, you know, drag all his body up. Okay, you might be knowing how earthworm moves. Okay, so there is a contraction and the relaxation of the segments. So if there is no contraction and relaxation, how will the earthworm will completely come out? Like,
that's what I'm saying. Like, are you hypothesizing that the whole signal to contract the whole organism and relax the whole organisms comes from one center? Like in human, it comes from one particular center.
Yeah.
So that's why if you put a lesion in between, you are blocking the road and the whole organ, the rest part is paralyzed.
No, no.
But in case of earthworms, in case of earthworms, as you said, there are many ganglions spread all across the organism. So, and we call them segmented organisms. And the why they are called segmented? Because each segment in some manner can take care of all the functions which is occurring in the other segments. That's why they are called segmented. So what I'm asking is, even if I cut the head part, the anterior, all the segments before clitellum, still that rest that part can move. So where the concept of paralysis and nerve cord injury is fitting?
Basically what happens, the down part, the posterior part, I'm giving a lesion in the middle, the posterior part will might move in some other direction. Like this guy wants to go up, but this is not getting that signal to go up. He may move down, he may also move up. So there is some coordination that, okay, you have to come in one direction, not you have to go in some other direction. So that would be
that,
something.
That coordination can only, like it can come from anterior and posterior. You know why we call something anterior of our organism? Because most of the sensory organs are present towards that side. We call it anterior. It moves towards that side. Any animal, human, cows, buffaloes, any animal you see, they often move towards their anterior side because they have most of their sensory organs there. So in case of earthworms, they have their mouth and major first six ganglions there. So if you see, go through the anatomy of Eosina fetida, which we did in the cube A and DC, so you'll come to know that most of the sensory parts are there in the towards the mouth part, so we call it anterior. That's why when it moves towards one side, all the rest of the body comes. So I agree with the fact that there is a coordination, like coordination comes from the anterior part. But I'm asking, like, where does the model of spinal cord injury as a paralysis fits in? Because the rest of the part without an anterior part is also moving. It's not paralyzed, right? It is moving, but moving in a different direction. That I agree. But it is moving. So it's not paralyzed. There's no concept of paralysis in earthworm. Don't you think that?
Yeah, I would say that. Like, I never thought of that. So I think I should think about that.
Before reading the VNT, I would suggest you should read about the how earthworm actually moves and where the ganglions are actually, so that you can better decide where to put a cut, so that some of the segments we can study, like whatever objective you are trying to study, maybe you can study it, but in a restricted segments or through a restricted cut, and how deep should be the cut, because all these things forms the basis of what you are going to study. What if you are putting a cut, but the spinal cord is not injured at all? And you are thinking that it's moving or it's not moving. And what if the earthworm is not only moving because it's injured? Sometimes when organisms are injured.
So that's because we are giving a dorsal lesion. Like, as you are seeing, like, it's because of the injury he might not be moving. But in dorsal, like, there's no ventral cord, so it should move properly. So for dorsal control, we have seen that it is escaping from that solution. So personally, we don't think that injury is a major thing for that.
don't you try, like, you put a lesion in the middle, or you totally ampute the earthworm in the middle, and then see for the two remaining parts, the anterior and the posterior, what is there, like, do they escape from the solution? Have you tried this?
No, we haven't tried that.
So if both of them escape from the solution, like, then you have to reframe and remodel the experiment, right? You should test it first. Cut the earthworm in the half, put both the halves in a solution, because both the half will wriggle. Okay. So do they come up or not?
Okay, then we could take help of them.
Coming back to your previous question, the ventral nerve cord in the earthworms quite much resemble the spinal cord in the human beings. So if we basically try to figure out what is the mechanism of regeneration in the earthworms, we can probably correlate it to human beings and then lead to the restoration of the spinal cord in human beings as well.
I totally agree with that. But what I'm saying is, in human beings, the signal, maybe the signal is coming from one center, right? For the locomotion, the voluntary movements which we are doing, except for the reflexes, the signal is coming from the center, the brain. Like if I want to lift my arm, I need my brain to active. But in the earthworm, like she said, there are different ganglions which can independently give a signal to a segment to move. So where you are putting a lesion is very important. If you are putting a lesion and on both sides there is a ganglion, that lesion is of no use. It's not discontinuing the signal, right?
Whereas I think even if they put a lesion between the two ganglions, like there is a ganglion here and over here, and they put a lesion in between, even that will work, because even in that case, there won't be the coordination between the, suppose the right side ganglion and the left side ganglion. There won't be the coordination. The neurons over there will be cut. So how will this part know that where it has to move? That was the basic set. They don't stop moving, even in their RER assay, they don't stop moving at all. But what we have observed from, I don't know, the videos are not playing, but what we have observed is that they do move, but it is not very coordinated movement. Both the parts move, but it is not coordinated in order to help the earthworm escape from the test tube.
So you have seen that, right?
Yeah.
So if I just remove the mouth part, it is it same as I am amputing it from the middle? Because it is moving to feed, right?
Exactly.
So what I am saying is...
But in this case, it's not moving to feed, right?
In this because case, mouth is not there. Mouth is not there.
No, even in the earlier, in this experiment, it is moving just to escape from that irritation which it is getting.
So for that, I suggested
that you check both. I don't think even for that, it should move towards the mouth only. It can move in any direction just to escape from that irritation.
So that will hold for the anterior segment as well, right? The anterior portion.
Exactly.
So have you, that's what I said, you check the both. Two halves, do they escape like in equal amount of time or not?
Yeah. This we should try, obviously.
And you can think of like where to put a lesion so that the other part is not moving at all. And if we can restore it through, like you can collaborate with the regeneration team, that whether it regenerates those ganglions and can move now.
Okay. So that's it. Okay, we have more.
My question to Manasvi Didi and Rishikesh Dada. Why are you putting, keeping eyes on Petri plate?
Yeah, that's a nice question. I don't know the proper reference to this, but I think that if we put ice on our hand for a long time, so the skin will numbness, and we are already comparing the earthworm with the like humans and human cells. So why can't we compare this criteria to the earthworm only? So that and we tried that and it's gone successful. Like they stand, they stop crawling on the ice. So we did that experiment for them.
They are just doing that to stop earthworm is moving vigorously. So while amputing, they have to count the segment and ampute. So they don't want earthworm to move continuously. So it's just to like
numb the earthworm.
Anesthetize it. Slop.
I want to ask the question to your first group. For cutting the earthworm, why only ethanol was taken as the antiseptic
So you can use any disinfectant. So basically, we want the blade free from bacteria and microorganisms. So you can use any disinfectant.
Okay, so
phenol
is
easy. Ethanol.
Yeah, I have a question. You said, So on 38 day observation, in one case it happened like 25 segments were regenerated, and in another case only 6, right? Of the 8 segments you cut. So I don't think it is, means the regeneration is as you want it to be, in specific. So are you still considering this as a model for regeneration, where you want it to specifically regenerate only 8 segments for cancer biology, right? You don't want it to regenerate more than the 8 segments. So are you still considering it as a model?
Yeah, as you earlier said that there has to be a controlled growth. You mentioned in the very beginning that there has to be there is a controlled growth in regeneration, but what we are seeing from your observation that it is not controlled, but it's growing beyond the amputated parts.
What they are asking is, have you observed in any of your earthworms, you have eight segments, and then you grow 10?
They observed that they cut
8 and it grew into 25 segments.
So among those three, the one you said it grew 25, it regenerated 25. What about the rest two?
Rest two grew more than 8 segments. Like it was So the tail part, which we showed, it restored the lost segments, like 25 segments. So the remaining two. So the remaining two earthworms, two restored 10, and some restored 12. Okay, so this is the anterior part of the tail amputation. So the first which the question was that they restored 25 segments from here. The anterior part, the bigger part. So the remaining two, we expected 8, but we got 25.
How many chances? How many
replicates? We have two more replicates. Yeah, it was not. Yeah, it was not specific 25, but it was more than 8. That is 10 and 12.
Okay.
It was not specific.
Okay, 25. So what you are claiming is that more than what was amputated, the regeneration took place. Regeneration not only restored but added more segments than what has been amputated.
Yeah.
When the tail piece was amputated, right?
Yes.
Okay, so that's the only generalization you can take. Not 25 out of this thing, but more than what is. More than what is amputated was restored and regenerated in addition to restoration.
Go and read about
If you read about it, why it happened, like, so I'm not going to give you the answer, but it, there's a very interesting thing about regeneration. Like, you know about planaria, it's the most studied organism for regeneration models. So in planaria, there's like whatever, from whatever orientation you cut, we came through this in cube by a goof up. What we did, when you used to ampute the earthworm, you used to ampute it like horizontally with respect to the segment. Okay, if you somehow by mistake ampute it diagonally, like some three, four segments are being cut. So do it intentionally and see what happens. So what you expect is, if the earthworm is like what you're drawing, it's in a horizontal plane here. So if you ampute vertically, it goes, it grows in a horizontal plane, right? But if you ampute it diagonally, intentionally do it for three, four earthworms, oblique, okay? So you will see the rest of the body is not growing horizontally. It is growing to an angle to the earthworm. Have you done that?
No.
We did it by mistake, and we also posted the picture. So then we go back, because that does not have any advantage to the earthworm. Because normally, for the regeneration is when earthworms are normally feeded and preyed upon by the birds and crows. So what happens is, if they are half in soil and half outside, the bird clutches it from the any part and tries to like pull it out from the soil. So it gets detached, it gets cut. So if the cut is oblique, the rest of the body starts regenerating to the oblique angle. Okay. So then we went back and we read, so there are two types of regenerations basically, homogeneous and heterogeneous regeneration patterns. So in planaria, you cut it any angle, it will again grow into the same orientation, the body plan remains same. But in earthworm, it's not so. So why is that? You can read it and you can like address more like beautiful questions about it.
Okay, so
take home messages.
So we so the tail restored more than the lost segment, and the head restored lesser than the lost segment.
How many times?
Three times. We have three earthworms. Three. In the head part, we got six segments restored instead of eight, and the we used three earthworms. So basically, the three earthworms show us the same result. That is six segments. That was constant. But at the tail, it was not constant. One restored 25, another restored 10, and another one restored 12. And the middle part is not restoring, posterior part. Middle posterior is not restoring any.
Okay, so what do you want to do now?
So next is, the basic question is, clitellum responsible for this?
So you are you saying that this was all, these were all clitellar animals that you used?
Yes, we used clitellar.
So then what's the question of clitellum? So if you used all clitellar animals and you are getting this restoration not exact and stuff like that, now why do you say about the clitellum involved or not? What's
because
the point?
Because what we observed is this part, the posterior part, restored. Again here the anterior part also started restoring, and in the middle again here.
No, it's not clear to us at all. You are saying that it more than restored, that's what you were telling earlier,
yeah.
Is it not? So what do you mean by that restored now? Now
means
you are saying it's
started
restored.
Regeneration.
Can you explain a little more? And see, it's a very complicated thing for us. You may be knowing it, but we are not able to understand. At least I am not able to understand.
Say that the part which has clitellum with it,
yeah,
regenerates, okay. But not the part.
The part which is smaller, 8 to 10 segments, any part of the earthworm, if I take 8 segments or 10 segments or 12 segments with or without clitellum, it will not regenerate.
So then why is this?
Have you seen any posterior part or any anterior part regenerating any segment? Have you seen that? The smaller parts?
No. The smaller part. But again, this is also the main question, right? It
so here you are seeing both the parts regenerating.
Where?
In the, when you impute in the middle.
No, the anterior part starting regeneration and it's restored all the segments, but whereas the posterior part is not restoring the this anterior part.
Not even a single segment?
No, not even a mouth.
There can be two ways of doing it. You use non-clitellar earthworms, the very young earthworms, okay, yeah. And you see whether it regenerates or not. So there is also previous data from ANDC itself, if you see. So they have done both on clitellar as well as on non-clitellar. And also one more thing, the answer can also be in like energy, right? To regenerate, lots of protein and a lot of things needs to be produced within a cell. And for all that thing, you need like energy, right? So can it be something to do with, if the smaller segment, it does not have that amount of resources with it to regenerate into a whole organism? Because first thing, it is not getting substantial amount of energy from outside. It's not feeding. Okay, so that's why it's clotting its wound. So you see clotting of wound in all the segments,
small
right?
Parts.
Yeah, so it means it is capable of initiating the process. The process is you clot, then there's a closure, then there's a bud, and there's a segment, right? Yeah. So they are capable of closing the wound, but they are not regenerating it, right? And then we went on to check the survival, like for how many days that smaller segment, anterior or posterior, survives. So it can be a possibility, I'm just suggesting, that it closes its wound, but it chooses not to regenerate, but to survive on whatever energy it has for whatever time it can. So for how many days you saw the survival of the smaller ones?
One was the remaining two wells we showed in the report. See. These all smaller parts died, and these part remained.
You had to tell when did it die? When did you observe it dying? You know, so okay. please tell us some details.
Yeah, so the anterior as well as the posterior part, the shorter segments, died on before fifth day of post amputation. Before fifth day post.
All of them.
Yeah.
Okay. This is when the amputation was done within six segments or eight segments or what is it? Please give us
eight
some details.
Segments.
Very clearly.
These are the eight segments.
Because you were telling about a posterior segment there, it healed and it survived for long, is it not? Earlier in one of the cartoons, you have shown that. In your figure, that one of the figures earlier, in the earlier slide, you have shown that the larger posterior piece, they survived for long, is it not?
Yes.
So what? So you had to tell us what is the number of the segments which didn't survive. When the number of segments were this, it survived for long, etc.
You only have the answers in your data. If you just look, what is the difference between a posterior segment which is amputated in the middle? It just have more number of segments, yeah. Without mouth, without clitellum, and another posterior segment which is just eight segments without mouth, without clitellum. So they are same in other respects except for the number of segments. Is it right?
Yeah.
And for one, you are seeing the survival is just 5 days. For the other, you are seeing the survival is?
94 days.
94 days, yeah. Right?
Yeah.
And both of them are not capable of feeding from the soil.
Yeah.
Is it something else for this bigger posterior segment which is making it survive for 94 days, whereas the smaller eight segments, that also posterior, cannot survive for 5 days? Right? There is, definitely there is something, right? Both are capable of closing their wound. Okay, but the survival is different.
But do you agree with that, what he is concluding?
Yeah.
Do you agree with that? So yes. To me, there's very interesting thing. First thing, I have a complaint to you, because all these things that you have been getting it, you people have not been reporting it at all. So all this thing in the last 20 minutes or something, we will have to understand it. But otherwise, everybody has been communicating and telling it. So that's my complaint. So the best thing is that you could have reported it every time regularly. So that all of us would be privy to it, we would be knowing about it, so we don't have to break our head over this, you know. Yes. It would have been okay. So my point is this: so if you got the middle amputation, what you wrote as middle amputation, the PT something that you had, the longer piece, yeah. The longer posterior piece, which you claim that it is survived. That's what I understand. Yeah. It survived for 94 days or something.
Yeah. Yeah.
Don't you think that's a very exciting thing? Though there's a rider, he says that the other didn't survive, maybe because... So you had to ask that, why did it survive? Now, the point, that's the first question. But the second point is much more interesting. If it survives for 90 days, that is 3 months, you can do a hell of a lot of things on that because it's a tissue culture system. It's an organ system which is surviving without anything. You had to only pour water and that's it. It's surviving.
And as they said, without all the anterior signals, without coordination, without anything, it's surviving for 90
days. The point I'm trying to say is that you can study a lot of things in that in 90 days. Immune system studies, you can do it. Metabolism studies, you can do it. Fat metabolism, you can do it. If the fat is what is being used, the preserved fat is what is being used in order to maintain the metabolisms so that they can survive and things. So this piece is a very, very extra interesting piece. Yeah.
So normal behavior assays can also be done, like the things which are, what is the opposite of attractive?
Repulsive.
The things, the chemicals which are repulsive to an earthworm, like when to a normal earthworm with a head and all those things, how it behaves and how this segment, which is surviving for 94 days, how it behaves without the anterior part.
Okay. Right? The last half a question. So how many such longer posterior pieces survived at your hand for 90 days and things like that?
Only one piece survived up till 94 day.
Because it was one out of three.
One out of three. See, the point is that is 33%. Okay, even if with all your casual treatment, one third of the animals survive. So that means you can actually develop that into an interesting model system.
Yeah.
If you do in 10 earthworms, three or four does? Like you should you should increase your N to get something substantial out of it, right? Maybe it's just the super earthworm.
Okay.
Maybe others don't survive. Yeah, maybe all of them survive.
Yeah.
I mean, I have a suggestion. The suggestion is, I am also been hearing about the same experiment for several years.
Right.
But, there is something interesting happening now, which is the survival of a part of the body which doesn't feed.
Yeah.
And it looks so nice. It has life in it.
Yeah.
And it is undergoing cell division, as you can make out. And I think most of the people everywhere in the world must be discarding that.
Yes.
Yeah. We cubists will not discard that. We'll convert that into a model system.
Yeah.
Okay,
forget about regeneration.
Yeah.
Come to that part, then that will be like a biggest contribution of the cube to the rest of the world.
Yeah.
And seek the attention of all the big biologists to this piece. I mean, when we looked at the pictures and the videos which were sent from A&D College last time, and then it is getting repeated again. That means it's a replicatable study.
Yeah.
It's happening in your petri dishes, it's happening in Delhi, it must be happening in all the other places. So if it happens, that would be great. So forget about that. So replicate the pieces, and how long do they survive? 96 days, I mean, my goodness, this is real life. I mean, what's the life of an earthworm, by the way?
It is around a year. It is 2.5 years and 3 years. Earthworms can live for years.
So which means that this fellow is still...
A major amount of its life, it can live without a head.
Life. And then the question is, I'm pretty sure that it must be feeding on something else.
Yeah, right. Is there any alternative?
Is there any alternate thing? Is it just diffusing? Then the question would be, start adding some nutrients in the medium yourself, and see if you can, prolong it further. Absolutely, yeah.
So ANDC started doing this by putting some glucose solution, 10 to 20, different concentration of glucose solution in the media, in the tissue itself,
right,
and to see whether these small 8 segments, is their life prolonged?
Yeah.
Like if there is diffusion, some
absolutely
kind of...
So you can convert this into a major experiment.
Yeah.
Because that regeneration, everyone has
then
seen.
As you can see, living is not enough. Living happens only when you fight against the environmental perturbations, which means bacterial infections and things like that. That means immunity question comes up.
Right.
It would possibly become and turn it out into a fascinating thing, like worm without a hole surviving. Without a mouth, without an anus, no feces, but then surviving. That would be a fantastic system. And also to check whether the segmentation, number of segments are increasing or decreasing in that piece. So there's a lot of experimental possibilities out here, and getting excited about this.
Yeah, okay, I think we are running out of the time. So we will call the other next group, that is Drosophila group. So basically there is a lot of, you know, the evolution is major topic in the biology, you know, whole biology, you know, doesn't make any sense, you know, except in the light of evolution. So they are studying actually evolutionary aspects of evolution in the Drosophila. So I will call Harshita and Ruchi. Okay, they will be called. Okay, Afsana, Rizwana, and Farin, yeah, from Adarsh.
Good afternoon, everyone. We are from Chembur Naka MPS School. Our project name is Drosophila. So we were in Drosophila, the catch the fly, and after that we study the activity pattern.
Yes, so our objective of the, like, we started doing the experiment, like how should we trap the fruit fly. We started doing it, so the method of fruit fly trapping. So we trap fruit fly. So how we trap fruit fly, I'm just going to tell you about that. So we have to take the, like, transparent bottle, a 500 ml bottle or big bottle we have to take, and then we have to take the cotton and rotten banana or peel, and then we have to take the label. So we take the transparent bottle, and in that bottle we put the banana peel inside the bottle, and then we put the label, like, time, what is the time, we put that on, like, we label it, the bottle, and then we keep that bottle near dustbin or kitchen, and then we see, like, how many flies has been come or not in that bottle. So like this we have done, like, this is the method of trapping fruit fly. We always trap like this only. So we have trapped, like, we have trapped the fruit flies 1 year. So we have seen lots of, like we have seen lots of things in the fruit fly while we're trapping.
So that after we were trapping a fruit fly, we get some data, and we are conclude. So
our objective was, like, we trap the fruit fly like this. So our main objective was that, like, we wanted to see that activity rhythm of a fruit fly, like, at what time they are most active and active. So we wanted to see that. So for that we so for that seeing that activity rhythm of a fruit fly, we have drawn a graph, like, so we put the bottle near kitchen or dustbin. So we keep the bottle at 7 a.m. to 9 a.m. in the morning, and like 7 a.m. we keep the bottle, and then at 9 a.m. we come and check the bottle, like, how many flies has been come in that bottle or not. And then similarly we keep, then we take that bottle and count the number of flies, how many flies is in that, and then we count and we write in our logbook. And then 9 to 11 again we keep two bottle, and then see after 11 a.m. we see, like this. We do this experiment till 9 p.m. And so we have observed that, like, the flies are more active, like, here. So, like, Jan to March, we have seen that flies are more active at 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. and in the evening 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. they are more active. And in July to October, we have seen that peak has been shifted little earlier, like 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. and 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. So we have the reason also behind this.
2017 we got the same data like that March Jan to March 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. and evening 5 p.m. to 7 p.m.
So as Rizwan and Afsana told that peaks were shifting, in lab we came and discussed, so we came to know that in this all there is called equinox also happened. So that here we can see Jan and Feb. So here we can see December. So in December the night is longer and day is shorter. So because of that our peak was coming 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. because night is longer and day is shorter. That's why sunrise later. That's why we got 11 a.m. and 1 p.m. And then after July to October we saw that our peak was shifted little bit earlier. Then again we came to see in equinox. So here we can see in June day is longer and night is shorter. Then we conclude that in July to October our peak was little earlier because of the equinox, so 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Then again we see our peak was then November to December we can again see that our peak was same 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. because of the equinox.
So like that time is shifted earlier or later. So that have some problems like jet lags or sad disease. In summers, in winter season, many people go in depressions because of that that is climate happening and they can't survive in the seasons and that. So we were studied. We will study about take a fruit fly and then to what is the problem and how to change this disease and how to conclude. Thank you.
Yeah, but are you connecting? Because this year's Nobel Prize has gone for actually this work. Means this is a part of that work, you know, that the activity. Yeah, so you can talk about something about.
They should have got the Nobel Prize.
Yeah. So this work actually has got the Nobel Prize of this year. That the activity. I wanted to add that. You know, they are actually deciphering that what kind of why this type of activity is there in the fruit flies. Like, why do they sleep at particular time? Why do they are active at particular time? So there are many hormones in our body which are activated at that time. Which means there are some gene regulations which are happening at that particular time. All those things are so. This is a very beautiful model for this studies, which can be. So this kind of work is very much is a frontier area.
Anyone has any immediate question? Yeah, you have.
How you can identify Drosophila is male or female?
Through the abdomen of the fruit fly, we came to know that it's a male or female. So, if the abdomen of a fruit fly, it's a fruit fly have a spot or like black spot on the abdomen, then it's a male. And if the female have the white abdomen, so through this we identify male and female.
Yeah.
So is it how you do it? Is it you put a large number of bottles and you go and plug each bottle at different time points? Or how
every day we were do experiment and return data in logbooks
and then when we plot a graph, everyone's data take it and every particular time to calculate, then I plot it.
So we count, like we take the bottle, first we keep the bottle near dustbin or kitchen, then we like plug the bottle with a cotton and then we pick it up the bottle and we count like with our naked eye. Yeah, like 9 a.m. we keep it the bottle and then at 11 a.m. we come and we pick up and then we count and then we write.
Then you put another bottle?
Yeah, yeah, place of, yeah, yeah. Like this we do till 9 p.m.
So,
yeah. So this is, yeah, so like month data we have plot, like month all, we total everyone's.
Total number of flies you collected between 9 and 11.
Yeah.
Anybody have a question?
So at some point, like we will conclude male or female, but at some point we can't conclude because at some point a fly is coming in more than 20 or 25 or 20, so that we can't able to conclude if female or male or how to that to yeah.
Yeah, we can.
Yeah.
No, so like we keep the flies in the bottle only, like for 2-3 days it's in the bottle only, and then after 2-3 days we like wash the bottle and reuse the bottle. So we like no, we like leave them, like plug, we take it out the plug and then they go.
Okay, so good afternoon everyone. I am Ruchi Modgekar from Elphinstone College and we are working on the model organism Drosophila. The title suggests that we are trying to develop Drosophila as a model system for studying aspects of evolution. So as we all know, Drosophila has olfaction as its primary sensory modality for finding food and hence used for studying various some of the core neurological aspects. Along with these, it is also used for studying evolution. Then we have a special line called CSBZ flies. Those are the Canton special Brenza flies as mentioned. And these flies were trapped by Seema Benza in Canton. These flies are cultured in this media bottles, that is a ready-made media that is provided to these flies. So for approximately past 2000 generations, these flies are cultured in this particular way. So, these flies, the CSBZ flies, these were later identified and they happened to be Drosophila melanogaster. Like the complete identification is done of these flies. Now, talking about evolution, the phenomenon of natural selection, it's like there are D. melanogasters in wild as well as the CSBZ. They are the CSBZ. And if you consider the phenomenon of natural selection, it's seen this selection is seen prominently in native, that is the wild Drosophila melanogaster, meaning only the flies which have the better ability to smell even the lowest concentration are able to survive
Whereas if you consider the CSBZ, this selection is absent because these flies are provided with ready-made nutrition. And this difference, we are considering that this difference of providing artificial environment would be a quantifying reason for difference in the olfaction behavior of these two flies. Thus, larval olfactory assay provides us evidence for behavioral differences in these flies and larvae due to the selection of natural, due to the phenomenon of natural selection. The objectives will be explained by my colleague Harshita.
Okay, so as the abstract says that the CSBZ flies have been cultured for past 2000 generations. So, you know, the CSBZ are being kept in an artificial environment. An artificial environment means we are ready-made, there is a ready-made environment which we are providing them, and it is very easy for the flies to survive in that environment. So because of this, there are certain changes. Like in environment, there is something very natural. But here, when you provide the artificial environment, that is the ready-made culture media in which we are keeping the flies, there are certain conditions which can lead to the difference in the olfaction behavior. As she said, that Drosophila have their primary sensory modality as olfaction. So for the survival of any fly, a fly has to sense the food, has to smell the food, and that's how it goes to the food it eats, and that's how it survives. So there are some difference in the olfaction behavior of a fly that are carried out at the genetic or the molecular level, which are random, which are natural. So we need to study what these certain changes lead to. Also, we need to develop Drosophila as a model organism for evolution and to study what are the natural selections occurring. Now, to study these long-term objectives, we need to carry out the experiments which lead to my immediate term objective, that is maintaining the single line and the CSBZ cultures. Now, for comparison of the CSBZ flies with any other fly, we need to have a single line culture. So for that, we have our culture, that is RSLV4 and RSLV3. It's Ruchi single line Vasai, because the flies were trapped in Vasai and Ruchi was the person who catched the flies. So those were our single line cultures. So we need to maintain them. Also, we need to standardize the olfactometer. Now, we are mainly studying olfaction in these flies. So we need to carry out the experiment, that is olfactometer. And standardization of that experiment is important to get proper results. Also, the short-term objective is identification of the single-line flies. Now, if my single-line flies, that my native flies, are not Drosophila melanogaster as the CSBZ flies are, so there is no point of comparison between these two flies. Hence, identification is very important. Also, we need to carry out the olfactory assay in more replicates. As in, if I'm just carrying one or two sets of runs with the olfactometer, then I cannot conclude my hypothesis or my long-term objective, which will either be very close to my hypothesis or it can be absolutely wrong. So what my hypothesis are, so now that my CSBZ flies are being kept in a very special environment, there are certain changes in their olfaction. Now, it's been known that the fly has maxillary pulp and antennae through which it senses. It senses the molecules, and that's how it goes towards the food. So for example, here it's written that we expect that our native line cultures should be more sensitive than the CSBZ culture. Now what? Okay, so now we are keeping the CSBZ flies in culture media, that is in glass bottles. While are kept in the natural environment for so many generations, right? Yeah, so that's the second image, is the bottle wherein the bottles have been kept, flies, sorry.
Oh God.
So there are many cases in this. Now my CSBZ is being kept in the culture and they are not that sensitive, as in the concentration of the smell in the bottle is very high. Like if I am talking about the receptors which are responsible for, you know, sensing the molecule, So in CSBZ, the molecules around one receptor will be huge amount. So they can easily get bind and they can smell. Whereas in native, if there is shortage of food in the environment, the native ones which have got a better olfaction and the flies whose receptors are very sensitive, or else like when I say that there is only one or two molecule in the environment and the fly has to sense it, so the receptor has to be that much good enough to sense that even one or two molecule so that the fly can go towards the smell. So that's the reason why I say that my hypothesis states that my native flies should have a greater olfaction rather than the CSBZ flies. Also along with that, we can say that these CSBZ flies have been cultured from 50 to 60 years. So like there are approximately more than 2000 generations in that bottle itself. So there can be some mutations in the genes which can lead to the gene mutations which can lead to the synthesis of prohibit the synthesis of the receptors, because of which the flies might not sense the molecule and might not go towards the smell. So this is what my hypothesis states. Mutation in the olfaction receptors of CSBZ. Yes. There are chances, like, that's what our hypothesis is.
So as Afsana and Rizwana explained how we do the trapping, so I'll just brief up with the protocol. We take a dry plastic bottle and add a banana to it as it acts as an odorant or attractant, you can call. And we keep this, we also wipe the mouth after adding the banana so that the flies go inside the bottle and not just stick around with the mouth.
Also there is one another alternative that you can take any plastic sheet, something which is about thick, that we use to cover our books. Like, if you can make a funnel out of it and you can keep on the mouth and you can add the banana peels.
Yeah. And then we place these bottles in the areas where the chances of getting the Drosophilas is more, like somewhere near the dustbins. And after particular intervals of time, we can just go and observe there is presence of fly. And if we have flies, just plug it with the cotton and get it in. Now, as she said, we need a single line culture to compare the olfaction. What we do is we have a mixed culture, and there are gravid, that is pregnant females, normal females, and male flies. The gravid females are those which would lay eggs and give rise to the new progeny. So we need to transfer one single gravid female from this mixed culture into a fresh media bottle. So how we do is we take the media, the bottle with the mixed culture, and place it on top of it, on top of the bottle with the mixed culture, so that, and allow some flies. First we need to check if there are flies which are gravid, which are going up as well. And as they are placed inverted, some flies will go up, whereas some flies will stay in the mixed culture bottle itself. And by doing this 2 to 3 times, we isolate a single gravid fly and then transfer it to our media bottles. So the table explains the composition of the media bottles that we used for the Drosophila. This composition is for 1000 ml. Coming back to the life cycle, the metamorphosis of the fly takes place in a span of 8 to 10 days. So when the fertilization takes place and a female gravid fly lays an egg, it takes 24 hours for the fly egg to turn into first instar larvae. First instar larvae is the first stage larva. Another 24 hours for the larva to convert into the second instar larvae, and another 24 hours to transform into a third instar larvae. So by day four, we have a third instar larvae. The transformation of third instar larvae to pupa takes approximately 1 to 2 days. And the pupal stage is for around 3 to 4 days again. So it's like a span of 8 to 10 days, as I mentioned before. Identification by Harshit.
Okay, so now we need to identify what my single line cultures are. So we have got RSLV3 and RSLV4, two single line cultures. We had RSLV1 and RSLV2, but we lost those cultures and we also had not identified them. Okay, so the identification of the single line cultures is like, first we need to find out which kingdom it is. So it needs to be Animalia, because Animalia are heterotrophs, they are eukaryotes, and they are multicellular. So a Drosophila definitely is a heterotroph and also a eukaryote. Next comes the phylum. Phylum is Arthropoda. That means they have jointed appendages, means they have the paired appendages. So even the Drosophila have paired appendages. And next comes class. Class is Insecta. Insecta, it means that the body of the organism needs to be divided into three segments, three parts, that is head, thorax, and abdomen. And also, it needs to have three pairs of legs, that is, and all the three pairs of legs should arise from the thorax. So that's how class Insecta has been identified in our RSLV3 and RSLV4 cultures. Next comes the order. Order is Diptera. Di means two, and Tera means wings. That means there needs to be two pairs of wings. One which is used for flying, and the other one which is reduced to halteres. So even we observed our single lines, and they were having the big halteres as well as the flies, as well as the wings, sorry. And next comes the family Drosophilidae. Family Drosophilidae is something from where the different Drosophilas and different species of Drosophilas are coming out. So we did the identification only till Drosophilidae, and we have not yet finalized the genus of our single line cultures. So for Drosophilidae family, they need to have a coastal vein, a subcoastal vein. Now in coastal vein, then there needs magnifying the image. That's not possible in PPT. What happened? Yeah, so there are two breaks in the coastal vein. The first vein of the wing has to have two breaks. Yeah, so we first started with the CSBZ. Either the CSBZ is having the two breaks or not. So it was having, and it was also seen in RSLV3 and the RSLV4 cultures. This and the two breaks, this first break and the second break. Next characteristic of Drosophilidae is that it needs to have a incomplete subcoastal vein. Now just below the coastal vein, there is a subcoastal vein. So these are just, you know, terms which have been used to as the characteristics. So the CSBZ had a coastal vein just below the subcoastal vein, just below the coastal vein, and also the RSLV3 and RSLV4 had. Next is the post-ocellar bristles on the frontier of their head, and it was seen in the CSBZ. We do not have proper images about it, but it was seen in RSLV4 and RSLV3 as well. So this concludes that all the characteristics of Drosophilidae family are there, which you know, are similar to carry out the olfactory assay with the CSBZ flies.
So what our experiment exactly is, we are carrying out the olfactory assay with second instar larvae and not the flies. What we do is, as I mentioned, the life cycle of the fly previously, it takes 24 hours to transform into a new stage of larva. So what we do, on a certain day, if we put some number of flies, say approximately for about 100 flies into a media bottle, we need to make sure that we transfer them back to some other bottle after 24 hours, which will will be confirmed that the flies are given only 24 hours to lay eggs, and after every 24 hours there will be a transformation from one larval stage to the other larval stage. So on day one, we transfer the flies to the media bottles. On day two, we re-transfer them back to some other or the same media bottles. So now the flies have laid the eggs. Now these eggs will take 24 hours to get transformed to first instar larvae and more 24 hours to get transformed to second instar larvae. So on day 3, I'll be getting my second instar larvae. So that's how I'm obtaining staged larvae for my olfactory assay. Now we need to harvest this larvae as well. What we do is, in the media bottles that contain the larvae, we add one test tube, that is 10 to 12 ml of tap water. And with the help of a brush, we give a swirl to the topmost layer of the bottle. As the larvae are feeding in the media, the layer is quite soft as compared to the solid media, and it's easy to scrape off the larvae from the layer. Once the larvae are in the liquid medium, we transfer the liquid into a strainer. As I have shown in the picture, we are putting all the liquid. So the strainer will drain off the fluid, and what will remain back in the strainer is larvae and some media particles that might stick to it. Then under a gentle flow of tap water, we just give a gentle wash to these larvae. And these larvae and are then transferred to 25% sucrose solution. Now, there is necessary that the contact of brush and the larvae should be minimum, as it might damage the larvae and we might not get the desired result that we are expecting from our olfactory assay.
Okay, so now we have the larvae, the staged larvae in the strainer. So what we do is take a brush and take the larvae from the strainer and put it into a sucrose solution. We put 25% sucrose solution, 25% sucrose solution in 100 ml. That is 25 grams in 100 ml of tap water or distilled water. It does not matter because it does not matter ki which water are you taking, most probably. Because you are just putting them for some period of time, for around 2 to 5 minutes. So after taking the larvae in the cylinder, you just need to wait for 5 minutes for the media particles to settle down. Because what happens is, when you put the larvae along with the fly, along with the media into the cylinder, the media particles clump up and settle down because of their high density, and the larvae float on the sucrose solution. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Okay. So for in the first image, you can see that I don't know if you can see, but majority of the media particles have settled down, and the topmost layer has the staged larvae. So in next step, what we use is, there were two aage ke do procedures the. Either you can use a strainer to carry out the further experiment, or a muslin cloth. Mayur sir was mentoring us, and he said that muslin cloth can be a good idea, and you can try it, and it worked for us. So we take a muslin cloth, gently wash it, gently wash it and make it wet, and the cylinder which has the larvae, we just tilt it up on the muslin cloth so that the larvae come out on the muslin cloth, and the media particle is just down in the cylinder itself. Now again, we give that muslin cloth with the larvae a gentle wash of tap water so that the excess of sucrose solution that is on the body of the larvae gets drained off. And in next step, the first image, you can see the maximum number of larvae are on the muslin cloth. And now we need to put this larvae in some solution somewhere where we can keep them properly, and then we can carry out the experiment. So for that, we use Ringer solution. Ringer solution is a composition of many salts. So it consists of KCl, NaCl, TrisHCl, and Tris base and HCl. So we directly use the the Ringer solution that was present in the cube lab, and we just take around 5 ml in a petri plate and tilt and just flip the muslin cloth on the petri plate. Also, if the larvae are not just sticking to the muslin cloth, we can pour some on the top of the muslin cloth so that the larvae can easily come off, and we get the staged larvae for our experiment. Okay, Ringer solution is a salt solution.
Now, as you see, the skin of the larvae are basically very delicate, and you need to provide proper osmotic conditions for the larvae to survive. If we put the larvae in normal water, there are high chances that the fluid inside the larvae body might come out. So Ringer solution is a solution that properly matches to the inner salt concentrations of the larvae. You can consider, yeah.
Yeah. So next comes the olfactory assay and the standardization of the olfactometer. Now for olfactory assay, we need to have a agar petri plate, plain agar petri plate, and the percentage of agar used is 1.5%. So what we need to do is first take a petri plate, and along with that you need a marker, so that you need to know where you are keeping your larvae. So a marker is a you know, exact size of circle of the petri plate, and on that you put the marks for this around 1 centimeter in the center, where you can keep your staged larvae, and exact opposite two ends of that you can put the sample and the control. So this diagram is of the control one. Now we need to keep the petri plate along with the marker in a black box. Black box is used because we want to eliminate the chances, so that I do not know that my larvae are having that they have properly developed their eyes or not. So I do not want them to use their other senses to like visuality, so that they can see the sample where it is kept and they just crawl towards it. So to eliminate that, I use a black box and cover it with a lid, so that they just use their olfaction and go towards the sample.
So being in second instar larvae, at that stage, this larvae has developed its olfactory.
Yeah. Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes, because...
Yeah, even we have read about this.
Okay. That's why you...
Second instar larvae. Yeah.
And not third?
Not third instar larvae. Okay.
Okay, now along we need to also standardize the olfactometer, because so for standardizing
Okay, for standardization of olfactometer, this is the control plate where we just add on both the sides, we add two drops of distilled water, like one on each side, and as she mentioned, the procedure, we keep it in the black box. So what if the larvae, what we expect is a equal distribution of larvae throughout the petri plate, but what if the larvae are just moving, as there is presence of some miscellaneous smell, and not by using their olfaction? So for this, what we tried was like for the marker, we are just dividing the petri plate into two horizontal sections. But after carrying out the olfactory assay to check whether the petri plate is properly standardized, what we can do is just divide it vertically and find the number of larvae present on both the sides of the vertical halves. And similarly, it can be done by dividing the petri plate diagonally and checking the number of larvae on each of the sides. So this can tell us that there is no any other miscellaneous smell that is interfering with my olfactory assay. So now, how do we calculate a olfactory response index? It is basically calculated on basis of the distribution of larvae on the petri plate. For control, what we do is put distilled water both the sides. One side, as you all can see, it's labeled C1 and C2. So it's the distilled water, and we place the petri plate in the black box with the petri plate lid and the black box cover, and give larvae 1 minute of time to get the olfactory run. After 1 minute of time, we remove the black box and click the picture and count the number of larvae on both the sides. So C1 is the number of larvae towards the C1 distilled water side, and C2 is onto the C2 distilled water side. Similar is for sample. Sample here we use is isoamyl acetate. This is the chemical which smells exactly like banana. Like, we are trapping the Drosophila and placing banana as an odorant. So isoamyl acetate is why we use as an attractant. Yeah. actually just we started the olfactory assays just few months ago, and so we don't have a very solid data to, but this is good. So what we did, there are many goof ups we did while performing the assay, which I mentioned later. These are the control runs and the sample runs. Samples here, yeah, we have used are the dilutions of isomyl acetate, which are 10 raised to minus 1, minus 2, and minus 3. 10 raised to minus 1 being 10 times diluted, minus 2 being 100 times diluted, and minus 3 being 1000 times diluted. So what our hypothesis says that for a control petri plate, we need to have an equal distribution on both the sides. So the olfactory response index for control should be zero. Yeah, and that for sample should be one. As what we expect is the larvae, all the larvae in the petri plate should move towards the sample side. There are difference in results because there were some of the goof ups that we did, like using same larvae for dilutions and for control, whereas carrying out controls later and doing the dilutions first and using the same larvae again. And these are some of the results that we got. What I would like to conclude from this result is more replicates that are positive towards our hypothesis will give us the threshold that we are trying to find out. The threshold is the smelling capacity that the CSBZ can smell and the versus the native flies can smell. And it will also tell us how better our olfactometer is standardized. So these are some of the goof ups. The two of the goof ups I have mentioned earlier, and two more are there. It's like when we started first preparing the media, we were ignorant and we changed the concentration of orthophosphoric and propionic acids. The orthophosphoric acid acts as an antibacterial and propionic acid acts as an antifungal agent. So we had just interchanged their concentrations. And the recent goof up was we didn't have sucrose available, and so we added glucose extra equal to the amount of sucrose while making the media. So actually we haven't got the results yet. We have transferred flies. That's the latest media that we have made. So we'll be getting back to the results. Yeah, but we are considering it that some mistake. Yeah.
Okay, so now our further plans are to standardize the olfactometer and to carry out good results that are either, you know, exactly similar to what we hypothesize or are exactly opposite to it. We need to carry out more replicates of the olfactory assay. That is, every time I'm doing a control, it needs to be proper and I need to do many dilutions of the isomyl acetate to get a proper threshold and get the results. Along with that, I need to study about what the receptors play important role in their olfaction. So this is what we want to study about, and this is our future plans.
These are some of the references.
Yeah. These are the references for the media that we used and the identifications as well.
As a last slide of acknowledgement. So that's it. Any questions?
Yeah, anybody has questions, please? Yeah.
So for the olfaction assay, did you use the CSBZ flies or the RSLV flies?
As I had mentioned, the olfactory run was done by just CSBZ flies. We did mention it. Yeah. We use CSBZ larvae and not flies.
Okay, yeah, sorry, larvae. Okay. So are you planning to do it with the RSLV
yes.
also?
Yes. Okay. Okay, yeah, yeah. So,
Yes, no. That's not the point that we want.
Yeah, actually, currently what we are
no,
doing...
No, no, no. The point is that, is there a reason why you worked with CSBZ flies for olfactory assay?
Yeah.
I think that's the question that was... Say, she's a very cunning person. No, she wanted to trap you. And you people escaped. So I don't allow you to escape. That you can ask, but this is an important. See, I think that's what Sheetal you were asking. You know, is it not? Why did what did you? Which? Because I think I will give you a cue. I think you were going to standardize the olfactometer. Is it not?
Yes.
So I think she was meaning that if you are standardizing the olfactometer, yeah. you should be using some standard flies to start with. Though you are questioning the standard nature of that standard fly at the end. That's what I think that's another question that we'll have to. Come to. Am I making it clear? You used CSBZ flies for some particular reason, or that just became it became handy, so you used it. That's what her question is.
Yeah. Okay.
I think so. Is it Sheetal? Yeah.
Okay. According to what I have got, the question is like we started the standardization a bit later. But CSBs and flies, we were done with little identification. Like we checked for the characteristics that were present, and we had a sufficient number of larvae that were needed for the olfactory assay. Whereas if you consider the single line cultures, they were not that well developed. But
Ruchi, the point is that CSBZ fly has got some value, is it not? What is that value?
Yeah.
What is the value of CSBZ fly? What is the CSBZ fly in comparison to Hamara Virarka fly or something?
Okay, the CSBZ flies, they have been cultured in the media bottles. So there is a difference.
Where does it come from? What is the origin of CSBZ flies? Where did you get it from? Now, do you want to really see that whether this is CSBZ fly is actually a Drosophila melanogaster or not? You understand what I am asking? Harshita?
Drosophila melanogaster is a species that has been studied for a very long time, and most of the genetic and molecular basis or the information or the content about the species has been known to humans.
But what is the connection between CSBZ fly and Drosophila melanogaster?
They are same. It's Drosophila. The CSBZ are the single line or the wild type of the Drosophila melanogaster.
What she's trying to say.
Now, what is the origin of CSBZ fly? You have any idea about it, or you are just saying anyhow? You are trying to say that CSBZ fly is like any arm Drosophila fly from. Bengal or Kerala or Bombay or Maharashtra or wherever.
No.
Yeah. They're Canton Square.
No, unless you have that, why should we bother about this? You know, you take one fly from Bengal and one fly from Kerala, one fly from Maharashtra and study it. Or is there something special about CSBZ flies? Okay, so your first slide has it seems. Could you just go back to your first slide? Do you understand the question that we are asking?
Yes.
Is there anything special about CSBZ flies?
So actually, Samer wanted to study behavioral genetics. Samer wanted to study behavioral genetics. No, you explained it once in the cube lab itself.
No, you have to tell the whole audience.
Yeah, in Canton, Samer wanted to study behavioral genetics, so he chose Drosophila and he started culturing it since then. So the fly itself, Drosophila melanogaster, it is being cultured since then in the bottles. So it's an
identified Drosophila melanogaster,
which
is cultured by Samer
Benzer
in 1960s or something,
yes.
And then the progeny of that and its progeny, progeny handed down to several people and it came to you.
Yes. Yes.
So which essentially means it's a very, very well-defined fly stock.
Yes.
Of Drosophila melanogaster. Now, unless we get that type of a emphasis on that, why should we bother about your comparison with Birar fly or Elphinstone College fly? So what is the importance of that? That's what she was trying to say. Could you, do you want to once again repeat it?
So Seymour wanted to study behavioral genetics around in 1960s. So he trapped those flies. After he started culturing them, he identified them as Drosophila melanogaster. And since then, those flies are still being cultured in such environment, like bottle conditions, media bottle conditions. So we have that going on.
Legacy
till
going
now.
On.
Yeah.
So you have a fly that has come from Seymour Benz's lab, which was raised in 1960s or something, and cultured in bottles after bottles, and it has handed down to you. So you know that it is a stock which has got the antecedents in Benz's lab, which is an identified fly as Drosophila melanogaster. What you are questioning is that when so many generations, 60s to today, that is 57 years it has been transferred from one Drosophila medium to the other Drosophila medium, which is a cooked up medium. Whereas your fly, what you are talking about, is caught from the wild. So its antecedents, its predecessors in 1960s, who would have been them?
The native Drosophila melanogaster.
So you may be comparing this, is it not? One that has been reared for several generations, several generations. How many generations you think that 1 year a Drosophila fly will give in a bottle?
1 year.
How many days is the life cycle?
10 days. If we
10 days.
Yeah.
So 365 days means 36 generation.
Yeah.
Sorry, right? 36 generation.
36.5.
Let's say 30 generation. You calculate 30 generation into 60. Okay, 2,000 generations. So one is 2,000 generations eating the ready-made food. The other is. Somehow they are managing from generation to generation, came to Virar. You got it from Virar, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's the comparison that you are trying to do. So you are claiming, I think what you said is that you are claiming that these fellows in Virar must have been going through several problems of finding food and things like that. So the only the best one who could find out, best one in the sense,
yeah.
The one who could really find out the food in so many generations once, in so many generations would be able to survive, and once also would have ducked several predators, because in the bottle there are no predators. So ducked so many predators, so they must have been having an agile body probably, there's a possibility. And they probably would be having a very good immune system, because they must have been surviving in very, very unfavorable conditions. So these are the type of changes probably you would be anticipating in a local one which has not been fed in the bottle,
yeah.
Whereas this one. So the point is, I forgot your name. What? Huh?
Naina.
Okay. So what Naina was talking about was that so many generations it has been fed ready-made food, whereas in your case it is coming from out.
Yeah.
So is there a change that you are trying to observe? So you are actually trying to observe the change in that, you know?
Yeah.
So you expect that the cooked up, the ready-made food eaten fellows. So that is the question. I think she was worried about it. That's the question we'll have to ask. One is that, what do you think will be happening in that bottles? You said that there will be mutations. That is,
yeah.
Something you mentioned to her as an example.
So I was asking, exactly mutation at the olfactory level?
Olfactory level as in we not know, but
I agree that concept that you said the flies which
but
are
I think it is, see, it is assumed that in olfactory level it must have, there must be some mutation, that mutation or some change must have taken place. That's what their assumption is it not?
In that cultured one.
In the cultured one.
CBZ.
In the cultured one.
Why it cannot simply be a
Okay, okay, that will come to. But what their assumption is, when from their suggestion, their assumption is that mutation must have taken place in several cases, several genes in 2000 generations, out of which some could be even in olfactory sensing mechanism. That's what their assumption is. Do you doubt in that assumption?
Okay,
that's the question that you'll have to ask.
I have a silly question that when I heard this, I thought about transposons. So the genes.
It could be transfer. Mutation can be by transposons or anything. You know, there could be several ways of mutations.
The mutation can't be stopping now over there. It can change also. The mutation can reverse also. I'm interested.
Yeah, but the mutation can happen, is it not?
Yeah.
So that's all what they were asking for.
So
I think the idea is that you should be making it very clear about it. So mutation can be by spontaneous mutation or by transposon mediated mutation, any type of mutation. It need not happen only in the sensory thing. It may be happening everywhere.
Yes.
The point is that any inefficient mutant that is coming out of that will be weeded out in the natural population, whereas this fellow will not be weeded out here. That's the point. So your first question is that would there be any mutations that is taking place and that will be stabilized there? That's the question. Do you have any doubt about it? You yourself are suggesting that there could be a transposon mediated mutation. So you don't have any doubts about it.
Okay,
lunch
we
break.
Have to break.
Can we just conclude in this?
Yeah, you conclude.
Yeah. So do you have some suggestion on that? See, she has a very genuine question. So your assumption is that there will be mutations and that mutation will be remaining there because they are not being weeded out. In the natural population, they will be weeded out.
So because I was worried because the CBZ, suppose there is a mutation in CBZ and suppose wahi mutation will happen in wild type. So how can you compare?
Oh, that's what the point. I think you didn't hear the last point I was telling.
Okay.
In the wild, in the native ones, if such mutation happens, that they cannot smell, will not find food, and they will die.
Okay.
That's what their argument is.
Okay.
Is that?
Yes, exactly.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I think, we have to break for the lunch. So lunch is actually outside in the canteen. So you have to come around in half, 45 minutes? Okay. 45 minutes, 45.
And as soon as you finish...
group photo.